My name is Krzysztof Kobaczek and I wanted to welcome you on my workshop about painting miniatures. For me, the last year was about developing my style and I will show you how I paint now, how I approach miniatures, how I try to show different things on miniatures. So it's my personal approach and I want you to see it. Maybe you will use some elements of it because it's very personal. The first thing about miniatures, about painting, I think you can divide it into three branches. For me, it's three branches. And the first thing is technique. So you should have the ability to use acrylic paints, maybe other paints, but to achieve smooth transitions, sometimes not smooth, but in doing this with purpose. The next thing is color theory. And the next thing is light, using light on miniatures, for me. Alias, maybe for textures, it's maybe the branch of the technique, because you can achieve different surfaces using different paints, using brush strokes, using dots, and it's very technical. I'm a very technical painter. I don't paint on impulse. I only analyze. I always have a plan. I want to achieve a certain thing on every miniature. So the first thing is light. You can see here an example. It's a basic object like a sphere. And normally in painting, in drawing, you can see that it can be divided in different parts. So to paint a sphere, to make it appear three-dimensional, it's important to have those elements in mind. So always we use light to accent the object and to show it as a 3D object. In nature, you can see we have always sunlight, always we have the atmospheric light that is falling from above. So in miniatures, many painters, like painters from Spain, because they started it, use light that is reflected on the miniature from above. It's called zenithal light. It looks like this. If you have a miniature, it's lit from above. Yeah, and you can see, even if you analyze all the shadows, how they progress, you can see shadows here, here, and the lower we get, the more shadow there will be. Every color, every surface will be darker. So this is light volume. And the more, the lower we get, the darker it gets. And always on boosts, on characters, it's very, very important to show the face, the head, as with this guy, and shoulders. Because those places catch more light. I don't use volumetric light from above, zenithal light, because it's artificial for me. I go outside and see where is the sun. It's not above, it's always here, here. And you will see that the sun produces light that is from different angles, but almost not from above, not every time. The second thing, it's using light in surroundings like this room, because here we have some artificial light sources. And we can use this for miniatures also to accent different elements, like showing a character that has light on the face, that has, we want to show different things. I will show you this on examples. So here we have different objects, like a sphere, like a cube, and two others. So you can see that changing the light direction, you can see this on this sphere. Here is from this side, here is from the back side, and here is completely from the back. You can see that there are many shadow lines that are very hard. Because if the light is focused closer to the miniature, the shadow will be stronger. If the light is higher, is far, the shadow will be very soft, very the edge, the shadow lines of the edges of the shadow will be very soft, diffused. So you can have in mind that how close is the light source. You can see this here. The light source will be further, so this part will be darker, but here it's closer. It's the intensity of light. So I try to use it on every boost. We use this for showing different parts. So I always find an angle of a miniature, like this one. You can see that the back, it's not so cool. I wouldn't want to show the back. So here, there can be more shadow. We can choose a light that will focus on the front, but not the whole front. But because if you want to achieve a focus, and I will talk more about contrast and focus on miniatures, you should show distinct parts. So I always choose something that I want to show. This miniature is very easy, because you can show only the face. For me, I would show only the face, and for me, it would be the main focus. This one, it's a little more difficult, because he has the face. We should show on characters the expression, but we should show different parts of the body, how they work. So he has a shield, strong gesture, holds the shield, and a hammer, ready for striking. So we can show the shield and the hammer also. And it's something separate, because we can use different lights, maybe focus the light here, and focus the light here, and on the shield more. The rest should be a background for the whole miniature. So then, if we have places that are darker, places that are brighter, we can achieve the focus, the contrast. We needed to show those parts. So, going back to this one, it's very important that every object has those places. Here we can see the main highlight, and here it's a dot, normally called in our hobby as a bleak. So it's a reflection of the light source in the surface, a visible reflection, and the reflection is more visible if the surface is smooth, less visible and diffused if the surface is rough. Then we can see the light, so it's here, it's brighter, this part. Then it's getting darker, and we can see a shadow core line, a core shadow, should be called so. So here the sphere loses the light from the light source. Then here you can see the place where it's the most shadow, because the further we get, we get to the reflection of the light source from the surface here. So here you can see the reflected light from this surface. So approaching miniatures, it's very important to do it, because then we can show the object is three-dimensional. So the backside, the lower from the bottom, will be lit by the reflected light. That isn't so strong, but it should be there. We can show, I will show this later, talking about colors, but we can show the same that is on the sphere, on this boost. Because here you can see the main light. This is this lamp here. But if you, maybe something stronger. If you put a red piece of paper here, you can see the reflected light. It's red. And it's very important to show the reflected light. And thinking about the surface on which the miniature is, the surrounding, because the light that is reflecting from the surrounding will have a different color. Sometimes the color will be strong, as this one. Sometimes the color will be less, not so strong. Even if we put a brown background, maybe something dark, it won't be that visible, but it should be. The light color should be changed. So this, you can see an example of the reflected light. And each object, like those, has a different way of reflecting light. I show you this because every miniature, for me, composes of such objects. So you can look at different parts, maybe an arm. It's round, yeah? So like this element. Parts of the face should be like a sphere. We should approach miniatures thinking about the whole general surface, not the details. Because if we go into details, then the light will be wrong. It won't fit, it won't be realistic. Some places you can mark too dark. Shadows on the, I can show here. Shadows here are visible, but are very bright. Shadows here are darker. And here, on this side, are very dark. So we should have the something in our head when painting to show parts that are surfaces like I show you here. So the head is a sphere. Yeah, here you can also have a piece of a sphere. And every surface should, I try to interpret like this one, like those elements that I show you here. So you can see an example of my miniature that I wanted, I painted some months ago. You can see that the light direction, okay, we'll go here, light direction is from this side. Maybe a little behind her shoulder. And you can see the main light source here, then the highlight, then it's getting darker, and you can see here the core shadow, here the whole line of core shadow, and here also. And here we have the reflected light, and also here to this line. So we can go back to the sphere, and something like this. So for me, showing light, achieving contrast, requires hard shadows, shadows that are very strong, because you have contrast. Here you have very, very dark colors, but here it's bright, almost white. The second thing, I don't use black and white on miniatures. I only use a black and white undercover. And for mixing colors, I don't use black and white. Maybe for silver or chrome non-metallic metal, because it should reflect a lot of light. But that's it. Next example. The light is from here. And you can see some shadows are painted. Some shadows maybe here are cast from the hand. But I assure you that on this miniature, this part here of her dress was very dark, because I didn't want to add too much light to lose this piece that the arm is casting shadow. So here you have the light from here. You can see it on the face. Here on the shoulder, and then the more we get to this side, it gets darker. The only thing is that I added an additional light source here to fill the miniature. You can see even more here. So from this side, yeah? And doing this, we achieve focus. So if you look at this miniature, my target was, if you look at this miniature the first time, you will see this place and this place. Because here you have a big contrast of color, here you have a big contrast of light volume too, and here you have places that are dark that give you this sensation. This one was a little lighter for me because I painted it for a company, Polish company, Valkyria, and those miniatures should be a little historical. So I couldn't use so strong shadows, so I made them a little lighter, a little. But I wanted to show on this miniature mostly the figure from the front. So if you rotate it, then the backs, the sides will be dark, because I wanted to achieve the core shadow line. So you can see the light sources from here. So here you can see that it's more lit. And here on her face, because I wanted to show the character, not the shield. This is background. Everything that you don't want to show may be darker. Use it as background to tell the story. But if someone looks at your miniature, you want to show distinct parts. Here, here, and hold the character. Also from the back. This miniature can be shown only in two photos, because the sides will be dark, there will be core shadows. just to achieve the contrast. So here you can see the shoulder and the butt. This one, as I told you, I wanted to show different parts. So using light volume, I wanted to focus the attention on his head, his knee, his skin, also the cannon. That was an important element. If you lose and if you use the non-metallic metal technique, there should be a lot of contrast to make the appearance of a metal surface, because it reflects a lot of light. So I haven't added white on this whole miniature, maybe for the silver metallic. Everything is not white, so I haven't added any white color. I use mini paints only from bottles, but most of the paints we use have additions of black, white. They are mixed. Those aren't pure colors. Those aren't artistic colors. If you want to mix, add white, black, we should use artistic colors. But I'm very used to those, so I know how those work. So for me, it's very comfortable. So going back, you can see also the difference in texture, difference in surface that I wanted to show. So here you have a very soft material that reflects diffused light, and it won't be as bright as the non-metallic metal. But we are talking about contrast, so we want to show distinct parts, and the other parts will be background for those. So here I wanted this to be only background, those red materials also. So you can see that the non-metallic will work better if it has background. So if you want to paint with metallics, it's not that important to don't use white, very bright colors. But if you want to show non-metallic metal, even not using white, you should have the whole surface that gives you a point where you can see the difference. So here it's very matte, very desaturated, very dark, but here it's very, very bright. And then you can see the white spot. Also here I used some light from here, you can see. But I used an additional focus point because the hammer was very far, very, very far. And I wanted to show this element because it's non-metallic. So I added an additional light source, maybe light volume here, just to focus the attention here. And it can be used deliberately to operate with showing different elements. So here, 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 here. Even here you don't have so much light as here. And also here you will see the backside. How dark is the whole surface here. Because if you wouldn't do it, you wouldn't see that light. There wouldn't be enough contrast to show this lit surface. Here you can see the back. Also, I wanted to show the cannon and this side, this part. Also the hammer. Okay. Can you show me what places I wanted to show here? Not the boobs. Where's the light focus in your opinion?
Yes. The picture,
yes. So we can think about this whole part. Here it's getting gradually darker, even to turquoise, because I added a lot of turquoise here. And the backside is almost dark, because if you rotate it, the miniature, you can see the light direction. Because if you would make the backside very bright, you wouldn't see it. So we can see it as I show you here. Yeah? We shouldn't rotate the miniature on the light. We should rotate the camera, our eye. So if you look at this from this side, you can see it here is dark. From this side, here is dark. If you want to show the light direction. So you can see it's getting darker here. I even wanted to hide the hand a little, because it's further from the light, so it's less lit than here. Here you can also see the core shadow line. Here, there's a different light source from the back, so you can see the outline. In photography, in art, it's called the rim light, something that is a different light source. Because if you would use different light sources, because we can use a main light source and then on the other light source that is from the back. But we should remember about those lines. There always will be some, maybe not so strong, because those light will combine a little. We can operate with the color of the light, because here mostly I use white light, but we can change it. I will show you this later. So, okay, going to the color theory. How many people of you know the color theory? A little? Kaha? Okay. So it's a standard color wheel. Here you can see the primary colors, red, yellow, blue. Here you can see the analogous colors. So those are colors that are very close to the color we have chosen. And here you can see secondary colors. Those are colors that aren't primary. So here, here and here you have primary colors and they form a triangle. But here and here and here you have the secondary colors. And those colors are the result of combining colors that are primary. So this and this produces this. Okay, going further. This is very important. These are complementary colors. So we are talking about contrast, so a big difference in painting. So even if you want to show yellow, using this color accents the yellow. If you would show it in even proportions on the miniature, then both those surfaces will show a very big contrast to each other, but they will all, both focus the attention evenly. But we can operate with saturation. I will show this later. So we can achieve maybe a focus on yellow more than on violet. So this is a color wheel I use for painting. I've read a lot of books about painting, traditional painting. And for me, the best book was James Gurney, Color and Light Theory. And he uses something like this. So here you can see more primary colors. So yellow, red, and blue aren't in those same proportions. But we can have also magenta, cyan, and green. So we can have a lot of variety to operate with color, to mix them. So even if you look at those paints, for me those are very close to the base primary colors. Maybe this one is too dark. But we should also use magenta, cyan, and green. And I show you this because for every miniature, I always plan my colors at front. I don't use random colors and don't experiment on miniature. I do, but to a degree. So here, the middle point in each color wheel is always gray. It's not, it doesn't, shouldn't have color. Normally, with our paints, we cannot mix gray because there are with additions of different colors. If we would use pure color, probably we wouldn't achieve gray because we don't have the same proportion. Always we have a hue of a different color. But it's important to understand that if you want the red that is fully saturated here to be less saturated, we can add gray or we can add cyan. A little amount, but it will move the red color here to the middle. So it won't be that visible on a miniature. So here I have something that I do with each miniature. It's a color triad that I designed for Neko Galaxy Nalani Boost. So you can see that normally, maybe going back a little, normally we would make a color triad using full saturated colors. You can see a lot of examples on the internet about it. Yes, a lot. I haven't understood them then. After reading this book, now I do understand. And for me, it was always, but why? But why those guys show at Color Triad this, 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 and this? And how does it work? Yeah, it has a meaning. So if you use this color, and this color, you should draw lines. And every color outside the triangle, you shouldn't use with this composition. So you shouldn't use saturated blue, saturated magenta, saturated green. But you can use them in a desaturated form here. So adding gray to those colors will lessen their effect and make them a background for those primary colors. So you can draw triangles as you want. Maybe from here, here, and here to have something like this. It's not important to have an even proportion of it may be something more focused on this side, maybe some focus on this side, maybe a big triangle. But you can design your colors. So I designed mine like this. I wanted to use this color. Maybe I like the bottle. And I wanted to use this one and this one. But you see that more of those colors are focused on the green, cyan, and blue side. So the whole composition, whole miniature would have those colors very dominant, but the rest won't be. I left something yellow, something orange to reflect the skin, but not in a desaturated way. So it's not so strong. And for the beginning of doing something like this, it's very good to leave the center because it's a gray spot. You can use gray to desaturate. Normally, you shouldn't use gray. If I would trace this point here, I couldn't use gray in pure form on the miniature. So that's it. The next thing, combining those colors, you can have the secondary colors here. And they can be used to accent the main color. So painting with this, I can generate contrast to this color with this one. So it's a complementary color. Also, I made an experiment here. I added a very big difference. I wanted to show something on the miniature that you will see right away. So this color is outside the color triad. And it's in a very far way from this color. So mostly the colors on the miniature are this one, but you can see that it's very complementary to this one. So you can see it on the miniature, we'll show you. Here, it's here. So you can see a big contrast on this part, because here you can see a lot of jade, a lot of turquoise, a lot of blue, and you can see the difference. Here everything is coherent, even the yellow is desaturated, but this part doesn't fit, and you will see it right away. That was my experiment here. So you can show places on the miniature with light, with volume, with shadow, but also with color differences. And here you can see the back. Here you used the same colors as on the front, but I changed the color of the light. So to every color that was on the front here, I added turquoise. So it shifts all the colors. Even the yellow looks like green because I've mixed it. This one is not mixed because I wanted the ends of her hair to glow. So it's a pure color. Okay, next color triad, maybe less visible here, here, here. You can see the dominance of red, less dominant blue, and the jade, turquoise. And it's this one. I added lots of red here, 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 lots of yellow. That isn't so much saturated. But you can see the green was almost outside. So I used something like this. You can see it on his cloth. It's desaturated with gray. So this, as I told you earlier, it gives you the difference. You have the freedom of color, but in a limited way. But if you use it right, then you can focus the attention of the viewer in two different parts. Also here, red, blue, and green. A lot of red, it was very dominant. Everywhere I added red to here, I added red to the skin, I added red to hair. But here also you can see the difference. Here's a play piece that is complementary to the red. You can see the difference, and I wanted to show this because when you add something like this, the red will be more visible. So you can operate with it. You can add complementary colors, but maybe not in a saturated form, to places that are very lit. But looking at this place and this place, this is background, but you will see this. But the eye will see the saturated color here. So also light and color. This one was very desaturated on the whole miniature. Maybe the browns are a little stronger, but if you look at the color wheel, we will have brown, orange, and then on the bottom, blue. So the whole miniature has an outline of blue here, and I added blue to every shadow on the miniature. You can see it here, here. So just to generate color contrast between this place and this place on the whole miniature. Also, this one has this, but maybe on the black background it will be more visible. I added a cold halo, I call it something like this, an aureola of coldness around the whole miniature. So you can see here, maybe not so much visible, I added lots of blue here, here, and here. So you can see that the blue maybe a little surrounds the whole miniature, but it shows the strong colors. Also this one. This one has also a green, blue underline, under light. So you can see those parts are more blue. Even the surfaces on non-metallic metal are with mixtures of blue, because I wanted to show a reflected light from the bottom. As I showed earlier, maybe it won't be that strong, but you can use it like so. The front will be warm, this color will be cold. So it will generate a big difference. So here you have the direction of the light, to here. The face was the most important part. And here you have something that I wanted to show, because it was important for the story, important for this character. So for me, this character only composes of the head and the cross, because that's the most important part. You shouldn't show the rest. This rest is just background, and even if you paint it with non-metallic metal, it will have a lot of contrast, but if you can operate with color saturation and the shadow to lessen the focus on the armor and show distinct parts. So you also one thing, I forgot about it. So the color wheel, that's the most important part, is divided into two sides. Warm colors and cold colors. So you can use warm colors and accent them with cold colors to show the warmth or the cold, or the cold color. So here was the same. I used blue from the bottom to show the warmth of her face. Normally in life she's very desaturated, because I add a lot of gray to mixtures, so it will be a little lessened. But you can see, but here this yellow is very saturated. So I wanted to make the difference. Blue, yellow, big difference. And you can see the cross, it shines. Because it's in the shadow, it has a lot of volume, and it has the color contrast difference. Also on the back. So the, here this effect is lessened because here we have more light, so it's more bright. If, we, if this cross would be here, it would shine more. So showing oriented light sources, OSL, on miniatures, you shouldn't plan. Put them in places that are, aren't that lit, that have a lot of shadow. There, they will be very visible. Okay. And the last part I wanted to show you, achieving contrast in miniatures can be through the surface that we want to show. So we can divide surfaces in such a way. So here is a very matte surface that is very soft, doesn't reflect that much light. Here, gradually, you can see more light reflectiveness. So it's gloss, but just a little, more and more. So here, you see only the light. Here, you see a little of the surrounding, little more, little more. And you can see here the light is very dispersed. Here is a little focused, stronger, and you can see a final bleak, something like we will paint in non-metallic metal. So if you look even at materials, at your clothes, they don't reflect too much light. But such surfaces that are glossy generate bleaks, generate reflections. And you can operate with this to achieve different effects. You can see the difference of reflectiveness in those elements. And here I've done it, I've tried to do it for her armor. So she has some reflections, but they are semi-gloss. They aren't full non-metallic reflections, because if I would do it, it would melt with the outline, with the details of the silver. So I wanted to make a difference. This reflects less light, but this reflects more. Also, the material is very soft. It's painted with dots only. So it generates a very soft surface that doesn't reflect too much light. So that's the difference I wanted to achieve. Also, the red is very soft. How about this one I told you? This one is also painted only with dots, the whole miniature. And here it was very soft, here it was stronger. More separated dots to achieve a different surface. Also here you have a difference, contrast. Destroyed metal with a lot of scratches, dots, very rough. And very smooth skin.
By dots, you mean the stiping technique, yeah, or no?
Yes, a little.
Pretty much?
Pretty much. I will show it.
Okay.
So, I want to operate with contrasts on each miniature to show different, distinct parts. So, here I wanted to show the skin on the miniature because I like painting skin. So, I wanted to build everything around the skin. So, everything here, here, here. Here, it's textured, but here, it's not. So you can see the difference. Also, you can see the difference with color, with the cold atmosphere, the warm atmosphere here, and also the light volume. So as I told you on the beginning, I always think about miniatures at when starting painting. I always plan. I always want to show something. And every miniature has its angle. So you can show from one side this miniature, from here. And this would be sufficient. But you can also show the back side. Maybe we should, yeah, because it's a miniature, it's a 3D object. It's something like approaching miniatures when thinking about 2D art, to paintings, because they only paint the front. You don't know what's behind, but they want to use color and they want to use light to focus the attention on distinct parts. I will show you my painting that I like the most recently. It's this one. So here, you can see the light falling from here, from above. But the main focus is on this character. And you see if we go further, every character is less alive because of the colors that this artist used. So he used here more live colors, more warm colors. But here he used more blue, dead colors because he wanted to show the difference here, here. And even the characters that touch this guy are a little more alive than those that doesn't touch. So that's what I want to achieve with each miniature, to show something like this, to show a difference in light and also a difference with temperature, with texture, and things like this. So yeah, now I can show you an example of painting. If you have some questions, feel free to ask. Black and white can be used as a tool to generate the volume. So by adding black, we produce shadows. By adding light, white, we produce light. But most of our paints are pre-mixed. So this is something with white. Because if you use colors that we like, it's not needed to add white. It's not needed to add black, because those paints have additions of it. That's not a pure pigment. And if you look at the color wheel, knowing your paints will help you to understand those colors that you have on the color wheel. So look at your paints and think, where should this color place on the color wheel? So on last workshop, I gave my students a quest to mix the color of their skin by using those five paints. But doing such things, and they mixed it. This one laughs. So, yeah, you can experiment, but you can paint with every paint you want. I use acrylic paints, scale 75 paints, because for me they are good. They have a good covering property. They also are very thick, so I can you can add less paint and dilute them more. Also, they are very matte. That's very important for me, because if you use gloss paints on the miniature, you can, but you won't achieve the light direction, because the surface will be gloss and it will reflect ambient light, maybe from lamps, and it will ruin the effect. So it should be matte. But we can use this to produce surfaces, like semi-gloss surface, but on places. So I use those paints from this workshop because they are a little glossy. And I paint with this black, I paint black letter. So I add this in highlights to produce the places that reflect a little light, a little more than I could achieve with matte paint. Okay?
Is there a difference between painting non-metallic metals? I understand matte is better, but if you paint true metallics, isn't some shade of glossy better?
Yes, but
to accentuate the shine of the true metallic?
Yes, of course. But for me, non-metallic and metallic paints, the technique of painting with them is the same. But we do opposite things. For metallics, we filter metallics to leave the places that are shining, that are focused light. But they are shining naturally because it's a metallic pigment that reflects light. But we should filter or even cover with dark colors, with matte colors, places that we don't want to shine. And for non-metallic metal, it's completely the opposite. So we want to show the places that show, but that's a shine. But with you should achieve a big contrast. So most people, I've done the same. Most people that when start painting non-metallic metal, they put almost white to almost black, because it's a big contrast, big. Yeah, but also we can do this with colors, yeah, as I showed you. So big contrast. Yes, glossy paints will help. Sometimes I use glossy inks for metallics because they are transparent. They give color, but you can see the metallic from beneath. Also, I use paints that don't have with me now, but I used the metallic paint, alchemy metallic paints from Scale to show surfaces that are metallic but have color. So those paints are a little weird because normally the metallic paints will shine where there's light, but those paints will shine, but if you rotate it, they will look like the color in the shadow. So here it's the example. I don't know if it's really, we will see, because I painted this one with those paints, this hammer. Okay. So you can see that here's the most light. So I filtered the whole bottom, but I added alchemy paints here, so they are visible. But if you rotate it, maybe to the shadow, they will be still visible because they don't shine, but they have a strong, bright color of the normal paint. So it can be used to generate the ambient light from the atmosphere, from the reflection, from the bottom. So I add those colors. Even I paint makeup on eyelids, yeah, to metallic paints sometimes. Because if they have color, you can use it. They will shine naturally.
But in general, you don't mix metallic parts with non-metallic parts in single miniature?
I've tried it. It was... Maybe it didn't work too much. Yeah, but you can... I've tried to mix this non-metallic non-metallic paints with the alchemy metals. So sometimes it can work, but I haven't developed it too much because maybe the effect wasn't okay. I think it's better to use metallics for different effects. So using metallics for armies, for miniatures that you look good from afar, you should use, you look good from afar, metallics are better, for, in my opinion. If you would put a non-metallic metal army under a normal light in a game store, in your room, they won't shine that much. They will be visible under a bright light under which we paint. But on a table, they won't. So metallics are better for this, in my opinion. In smaller miniatures, many people paint Games Workshop miniatures with non-metallics, but we don't have the whole surface to show all the reflections. We should simplify some elements. But on the other hand, the effect won't be that good if you would do the same on a big miniature. So I use non-metallic metal for bigger miniatures, metallics for smaller, and also using light sources. As I told you, non-metallic metals dominate the whole composition. So if you make something silver with chrome, if someone would look at this miniature, he always will see the non-metallic metal, even if you wanted to show something else. So that's you can operate it with it. And painting with the metallics and non-metallics is a good, both are good techniques, but for different things. Okay, I haven't told you earlier, some people know I'm a very slow painter, so I will show you some things that how I operate with paint, how I achieve a smooth surface, how I achieve textures to make those differences, and also how I add colors. Some painters use pure colors, as I mentioned, and they mix every color. But for me, I paint too long, and I wouldn't achieve the same color every time. So I always mix colors on my palette and do a plan of what I want to paint. So I will paint some soft leather and some rough leather to show you the difference. Yes.
You already explored those places that you yes. want to explore
okay.
the most. And I assume that after assembling, you cover it with a leg primer. And what's the next step? Do you try to mark those areas you want to expose somehow?
Yes.
Or
okay.
Just
for this miniature, for almost for every miniature, I'll make a light plan of the light source. So I do this with an airbrush. I paint the whole miniature with black, so I have the deep shadows, and then with an airbrush, I mark the light source. So you don't paint the whole miniature white, yeah? But you paint from the direction of the light. Here was something like this. So I took an airbrush.
With the final color or with the white?
I made a gradient. So first I added a little gray to the black, then more gray, then more white to achieve a gradient. But I've marked the
sketches rather black and white, not yes. The black and the color which is
yes. And
the final color.
The good thing about it, if you do something like this, some colors have it's called chroma, and some colors are stronger, like this one. Some colors are weaker, so like this one. So this color has more chroma, and also red, maybe saturated red, like this one. Yeah. Those colors that have more chroma will be very visible on white background, on the white undercoat. And those colors that are have less chroma will be better visible at gray, maybe darker color, darker undercoat. White undercoat for this color would change the color of this paint, probably. It will be too bright. It won't look the same like this. So we do the sketch. I do this light sketch at first because I want to have a reference. I always do the sketch and then take photos. Because even if I have places that I painted it wrong, I can look at those photos and I can see where the light and shadows were present. And I can use this to make corrections, to fix mistakes. In time, probably I won't need it that much, but now I always do it.
You also do this for smaller miniatures?
Yes. Yes. Because, yeah, you want to show a direction of the light. Sometimes it's a little artificial. For this one, I had an idea that the backside, you can see, it's more yellow. Okay? And the front, it's more white, more, it's the color is cold. So here the backside is lit by a sun that it's low, it's more yellow, maybe even orange a little here. And here, but it's lit, this miniature is lit from a light, so that's very close, maybe a lamp, maybe or something, yeah. Maybe a torch, something like this. So we can operate with different light sources, colors of the light, to show different things. So for me, most of the miniatures, normally they don't have the presence of their surrounding. So always when I paint, I always think about what's happening around the miniature. Even if you have something like this small, it's a character only, with a little of ground. But you can always, it's good to imagine what's happening around. Maybe some places like foliage will reflect light that is green, because white light falls on foliage and reflects green light from the bottom. Maybe there will be torches, maybe there will be additional light sources. You can show this on miniatures, but it's better on bigger miniatures. On smaller, you can use the surface is not too big to show the full transition. Maybe the effects should be then more dramatic. So I haven't experimented with small miniatures with this approach. Making a sketch, you can put, as I told you, miniature under the light, so you can see how the shadows fall, and then paint it with an airbrush. Use it as a light cannon to mark the light source, but only from this side, not from here. Yeah, from this side only. And focus, you can focus on places that we want to show. So here I added more white. Here there was only gray. Also here I added more white to show the place that I want to show in this miniature. Also the back, you can operate it with it. So maybe the back will have a weaker light source that isn't that dominating. So you can see the difference. Here's a little darker. Here's a little brighter. So that's the difference I want to show. Do you have more questions? I will mix the colors a little. So this is my habit. It's not needed to do for you. Maybe you have something that you, some way that you mix colors. I always make a, even thinking about painting a surface, I always choose my colors for it. So here it will be something like this. Those colors, of course. So you, here you have warm colors. That are some orange colors with additions of black or brown or blue. So, as we, I showed you on the color triad, we can use complementary colors to accent the warmth of this color. So we can add something like this to the shadow, or something like this, maybe darker. Yeah, but also we can add green. It won't be that strong, but we can add it. So you can have the difference, cold, warm. I will add green, because for this miniature I have chosen the difference that I want to show, because he will have, I will make a base for him, and there will be foliage around. So the light that is falling from above will reflect from the foliage and will be visible on the bottom of the miniature. So here, I don't know if it's, here you can see maybe here I used a lot of green. It's a green paint, painted on black, so it's not that visible. But it generates the contrast for the warmth of the skin. As for the scale paints, they, some are broken, unfortunately. So I've bought the first batch, and some of them have the property to divide the medium. So if they stand too long, the medium divides, but in a way that it's hard to mix them together. So this paint I haven't used for a long time. So you can see here that there's a lot of medium in this one. And here will be the reflected light with green. Okay. We can use this color to mix it with this one at first. So the next thing I use for acrylic paints is acrylic thinner. I use the acrylic thinner from scale 75, but I have a bottle with this one, from this one. So this one is okay, but if you add too much of this thinner, the surface will be glossy. And the scale 75 thinner is better in this regard because it's matte. So I use the scale thinner, but I have a bottle from this one. So for me, I always dilute my paints very much. I add a drop of thinner to every spot. And a drop of water. Also, I use thinner to dilute the paint when I paint, not water. So here. So you can see it's very milky, very thin. So with Games Workshop paints or Vallejo, you could add only the thinner, not water, because those paints aren't that thick. But with scale, you should add more, because they have a very heavy pigment and need to be more diluted. Also, the thinner helps to smoothen the pigment, because if you won't use it, you will achieve a rough texture of the paint, because it builds in layers too much. So I will use some elements, probably I will repaint them later, because maybe they will be metallic. I don't mind that much. So the first thing is to mark the shadows, the deep shadows, and places that will be very dark. So here on this leg guard, you can see that we can trace the light line here, but there, in this place, you can see the shadow is natural. It shows here. So we can color the shadow with brown paint. It won't be that visible, but it will be. Also here. Okay. So you can see I'm marking the shadows on this, all those elements to show the hard shadow line. We can mark it even more with this green, because it's a strong difference, complementary color. So it will look a little darker. And also it will give the appearance of ambience on the miniature, of the light that is reflected from the bottom. Okay. So now I'm making a color sketch of the to show where to place the light and the shadow. So now we can show the difference. Maybe something like this. Here, there should be more light. So you can always start with something like this to show places, to mark the places where you want to put the light source. And then you can even it out. Also, the undercover will show the bright colors like this. Those they will be more visible on gray and white. So if you paint with them on black, so if I would cover the whole miniature with the darkest mixture, then I will lose the difference. I will lose the undercoat, because all the colors, even yellow, won't be that strong on dark undercover. If you have some questions, then feel free to ask, because for me it's obvious, but for you it may not be.
Nie.
Staram się. For me it's not comfortable because normally I paint on my leg. Something like this. And or I have a very high desk, so it's a challenge.
What brushes are you using?
Mostly Wind 7 Newton Series 7. And lately I started to use something like this. Skoda Reserva. They are okay.
So like softer or?
A little softer and longer. You can see. Maybe a little, but that's okay. But yeah, it should be a high quality, natural brush, Koliński Sobol. I haven't used others, but there are some branch manufacturers like Rosemary and Artis Opus. So yeah, here I marked the light source that I want to achieve. And now, maybe with a worse brush, because making dots is not good for your brush. So we will build the texture of the soft leather just with making dots. So I can show you starting from here. Just dabbing with the brush, with the tip. If you get older, it will be easier because the hand will do the same this for itself. Yes, yes, I'm waiting for it. Yeah, yeah, but probably at this point it won't matter. So with this technique, it's very easy to achieve a smooth blend, because you put dots on dots and they will blend easily. If you want to do this with glazes, to achieve a smooth surface, it needs a lot of work. It needs more.
So you always blend like this?
Not always, but recently I always want to reflect different surfaces. Some surfaces I paint doing soft, smooth glazes to make something very smooth. But some surfaces I paint with this, and you can use a different size of the brush to make a larger dot, a smaller size of the brush. You can put the dots more separated from each other or very close to each other, so we will achieve a different surface. Don't use a good brush for this, because this technique will destroy the brush. So you always put a spot so it will be destroyed in a short time. So you can do this at random, totally. You can even make some spots on the place where it should be darker, because you add more texture to the darker places. But you should have this in mind, that the texture, even in life, won't be visible that much in shadows, because there isn't too much light to show the texture. So you should focus more on the lit parts. Then there you should add more texture. So at first the difference won't be that big, because I use very dark colors. But in a moment we will see it. Tarcza mi zasłania. So if you layer the dots on each other, the surface will be smooth, but you will see the dots. Also, as for the paint, I know now I put large amounts of paint on the brush, but I always clean it with a tissue, because if you paint with very diluted paint, it shouldn't have too much water on the brush, because it will leave large spots and they will dry longer. So I always remove the excessive amount of water and paint. So if you will see, sometimes the difference can be bigger. Maybe I'll dilute the paint a little too more, but we can cover it. So here you can see the big difference, here, yeah? So we can cover it with a color that we used earlier. It will be more saturated on the places that were brighter and less saturated that were on the places that were darker. Kurde. No okej.
Jeszcze ludzie mają puszki po rebulu. Nie tylko z
nie? Ja nie widzę, bo maluję.
Ja się schowałem za statyw.
Jak dostanę, to nawet nie będę widział, nie?
O, widzisz?
Cholera. So you can see that in time we are achieving a gradient. from here to here on the whole surface. So I always paint, I try to paint larger amounts of surface because I don't focus that much on detail. Don't focus on distinct elements, but you should think about geometrical objects, paint the whole surface, just to know where to put light, where to put shadow. So now I'm adding green to achieve more contrast, to achieve a bigger difference. It won't be that visible on black, but it's there. It gives its effect. And now to make the final highlight. If you see that the difference is too big, we can always go back to earlier colors and to smoothen the difference. But this can be done at random, because if you look at photos of leather, it's worn, soft leather, has a lot of texture. It has a lot more of texture on places that have folds, because it's a little stiff. So some places will scratch a little more. So we can add more highlight, and those colors, something like this, like Iroko, I add to show the places that are more that are most worn, because leather. If you scratch it longer, then you will see the inside, you will see the bright material, not the color of the leather. Also, it's very important to work on larger surfaces, because if you lose thinner, if you use a lot of diluted paint, working in one spot can give you something like this. Black spots, because I've long worked too much on this place and I washed away the colors that I applied earlier. So, yeah, everybody, you should think about give that paint a little more time to dry. So then those places will be very difficult to cover. So we can add more. Yes, a higher dryer is okay. But I just work on larger surfaces, and the hair dryer isn't needed. Maybe if you use washes, just to dry them out, but that's all. So, yeah. So now I've gave some time for the paint to dry. working on different places, but I will go back to the highlight and make it stronger, maybe overpaint it a little. So we can see this process isn't so fast, but it's easy to achieve a smooth transition because it can be irregular, but you place the paint where it should be, so the dots will melt a little. Can add some green to make contrast. If you feel that the paint is too much, too diluted, then you always can add more pigment. For this, maybe not for glazes, but for this, the paint can be a little thicker. It will cover better. But we can operate with it. Okay, so if probably you should use more strong color to cover this place that I think pigment washed off, but it's okay. That's about it. So you have a gradient, but it's with dots. But that's the whole trick. You can see the effect maybe on his armor here, because yes, that's what we painted on a workshop. But this thing was achieved with similar paints and with only dots. Also, you can use streaks. Not dots, only streaks. So with a thin brush, you can paint something like like this. Maybe I will find a place that is okay to show here. So not dots, but using only streaks. You can change the direction. So maybe make something that, some streaks that cross. And this, if you paint the whole surface with those streaks, will give a semblance of a material that is has crossed strands. Also, when making this texture, you can add streaks from time to time, but not at the end, but when doing it. So we can use different shades to generate deep scratches, maybe bright scratches. It's you can add a lot of more lot more texture. So to add maybe to make the material harder, so it scratches a little. Yeah, it can be only soft that you won't see scratches, but you can see the dots.
Could you please show this painted part closer to the camera? It's a change.
Oh, okay. It's a close-up to the... No,
this painted, I mean this, you finished painting. And a bit closer, is it possible to see these textures? Or
can we see it in person? Because, you know,
yes, of course. Yes, of course, come.
Right away.
Right. So it takes a while, but you can put only dots and make... Also, you can see this here. It was also an example. On his pants here, you can see the streaks. This pattern was only painted with streaks. So you can differentiate materials. Some are, you can see more strands. Some you can see that are very soft. So soft materials could be painted only with dots. Materials that have more strands, you can add streaks. You can operate with the hardness of the material, because some materials will have places that you can see the gashes, you can see its usage, so you can use streaks and then accent it, but you can't differentiate it. So here it was only a test, but you can see that shield should be hard, but it has a lot of streaks, a lot of dots that are random, that show places that were worn. So feel free to experiment with it. So it's not only glazes, painting smooth. But when we put those textures in right places, it will work.
But with this shield, the highlights on the shield, did you also just use the dots technique? Or?
Yes, it's only dots and streaks.
Okay. Also, skin tones?
We can, but here I painted all of the skin tones. I don't have an example to
no,
show.
Just the information.
Okay.
Dots.
Mostly glazes. It's better to do it with glazes because the skin should be smooth, but you can add some dots here and there to give the semblance of pigmentation, because the skin is, as you can see, it's not even, it's not totally smooth. So in some places you can add some dots to mark the tissue, to mark veins, normally for painting skin, I don't use too much paint. I can show you what paint I use. I showed them to my colleague here. That's this set, as you can call it. You can buy the same, but. So, about skin, I can see that here, this is a normal scale set, but I don't use those paints in pure form. Because you should have the knowledge how to mix skin color, I can show you. So having this in mind, you should those are primary color. Okay. Where's white? Black won't be needed that much. So the skin is a mixture of yellow. Also you can see that how strong is red compared to yellow. So the proportions should be something like this. So this is the skin color, but without white. So if we start adding white, it will start to resemble. Also, we should add a little blue. Also, the blue is very strong, so it colored everything. But yeah, we could add more red or yellow. You can see skin tone. Okay, so having this in mind, painting skin tone, you should, for natural skin tone like people, you should use blue to mark all the veins. You should use red to mark the skin, the blood that is underneath the skin. And you should have in mind that some places on the body, human body, have a very thick skin, so you won't see that much of the blood. Some places that here are under the skin, you can see bones. So here, if I would paint my knuckles, I would use more yellow to show the bones. Also on the head, you have places. So here, we should add more yellow. Here in this part, we should add more red. Here is yellow because of the skull that is visible through the skin. Here, red because of the blood and places that have a very thin skin. You can see the blood, and the blood is just from the artery, so it's fresh. It's not used. And here you can see more used blood, so we add more blue. For men, it's more blue because we have facial hair, so to reflect the facial hair, even if you are shaved, you have the residue of the facial hair, so we add blue here. So if you can make the experiment at home, mix paints, mix the primary colors and achieve your skin tone. And you can, even then, we can operate with it. So adding small additions of red. We will make the skin, I know it's not so visible, skin more reddish, more rosy. So adding small additions of yellow will add the resemblance of the bones sticking from underneath. But for my miniatures, I mostly use dirty colors. So I use a lot of gray. I add a lot of gray to the skin tone. So for Sibylla, for the Vampire Boost, I used this paint, and the rest was gray brown. That's all. You should add the small semblance of life to make this the audience believe that this character is alive, has a maybe a little natural skin tone, but that's all. You can operate with it. So those paints are used at the beginning, but you can mix everything. But you should have in mind that if the character is alive, it should have blood. The blood will have its color. If it's an alien, it will have a green color. If this, if his skin is transparent, the green will be visible from underneath the skin. So if you want to make it realistic, you should add something like this, because we are very, we operate in our reality, yeah? So we are used to looking at human skin. So for us, it's natural. So all those nuances, all those additions of red, there have a meaning. So we can use this thing that we are accustomed to transfer it to painting, I don't know, green skin. But you should add the semblance of reality to make it look realistic. So I add such colors, mostly blue, mostly red, to mixtures to achieve something like this. So on him, you can see here a lot of volume, a lot of light on the skin. Some also, there are muscles. Men have more muscles, more that are visible. And women have very soft, not big muscles that won't be that visible. But we can show them. We can show them with highlights only. So don't paint shadows on women. Paint only highlights in places that they have muscles. So if you want to show a biceps on a woman, here you should add only the strongest colors, yeah? So here you have a very big muscle. For here you will have shadow, but not so strong as here. So operating with the shadow, maybe here you should make mark shadows with mid-tones, middle paints, with something like this, but not with deep shadows. But in men, in painting such figures like this one, you can add more shadow to make the muscles stronger, more prominent, more visible. And also, I encourage you to remember about the light focus. So places that are more lit will have less shadow. Yeah? Do you have any other questions? Because, I can show you one thing. I can show you how to paint smooth, but it will take time. So, do you have some questions? Do you have something I can show you now regarding the information I told you? Yes, painting skin for me, I am a very slow painter. So, for me, making something like this would take 6 hours, probably.
Only this arm?
Only this part, this torso. So I can show this. That's why I also didn't want to make a workshop, full workshop, because for me an hour is not that much. Maybe if we would have 1 day, 2 days, I can show you how I paint such things. On my workshop, some people paint faster than me, then they finish it, the whole skin. I finished only the front, maybe the torso. But for me, it takes time. I want to make it very smooth, very delicate. So I add a lot of additional color, nuances. I make it in layers, because if you add blue and then cover it with skin tone, you can see the blue visible. It's visible from under the paint. That's why some people, there's a technique like that, cover the whole skin with green color and then paint with skin tone colors over it, because the green is visible from under the skin tone color and it modifies the colors of the whole skin tone. So yeah, we can use such things. And on this one I painted the whole skin, so it would be difficult. Earlier, when I was making dots, I haven't used the medium. Now I use, because I want to make glazes. So we do this with the, not the tip, but the, with the a little with the side of the brush. It should touch a larger surface of the miniature because we want to achieve the layering effect. So it's not a sharp line, but a more larger line of the brush that covers one. They cover each other, so this produces the transition. Just remember to do it with diluted paint and the side, a little with the side of the brush, not with the tip, only with the side, so to cover more surface. This one would take me 2 weeks, probably, of 8 hours per day. If I would go too much into detail, maybe make some corrections, it would be 3 weeks. But yeah. As for the Sibylla boost, I painted it 4 weeks. So I've talked recently with painters from Spain and they are way faster. So, as I told you at the beginning, use that what interests you. Everyone should have his own style of painting. But maybe this will help you to understand light, to use it more of light on miniatures. Try to think about the direction, try to think about the contrast. If you want to show a lot of light, like here, there should be a reference on the miniature, some spots that are very dark, because we want to show the difference. If you would make everything so bright, you wouldn't see the difference.
So the bus takes twice as much time as a 75-meter miniature?
Yes, because it has larger, more smooth surfaces. So if you want to paint it, I'm a painter that paints everything with a brush. So some painters paint with an airbrush and they modulate to finish the surface. I paint everything with a brush. So if I have a miniature like this, it has a lot of smooth, large surfaces. So to do smooth blends with a brush, it takes time. Layers. It's good to make color sketches. So as I started on the leg guard, to mark the shadow and to mark the light, and then to even the transition. So it helps. It makes it faster. Also on such large boosts, you can mark the places that have more light with color, and then with shadows, and then smoothen it out with mid color and with paint. So it should be faster. If you build color from almost black, it takes ages. So don't do it. Just don't do it. I've done it.
What colors from the range do you use for the sketches?
What?
You have a range of colors. Yeah?
Yes.
For the shadows, the
you can see it. You can see it here. So I can show this because that's why I do it like so, because I've made some tutorials, I try to work on it. So I always put colors on the palettes so I can show it easily. So here you have shadows, those colors, so shadows. Here you have mid-tones, maybe even here. And here you have highlights. So if you want to make a color sketch, mark shadows with something like this, then make a jump, mark midtones with something like this, and make a jump and mark highlights with the final color. Maybe never, even not the final, but maybe this one. So you will have the range of paint you want to use, and then with those colors that you haven't used, smoothen it out. But it's easy to mark the color placement, the placement of the light on the miniature this way. So then if you paint, you won't change it too much.
But you don't use an airbrush for the particular reason, or you just doesn't like it?
I don't like it. Maybe it's too messy for me. Maybe it's the I should have to take my time and learn the tool, because sometimes I don't like the effect, but it takes practice. And for me, I have the problem because I have a workshop, but I paint in my bedroom, so it's I don't have a lot of place. I don't have a box with maybe an air filter or something like this, or maybe always when I paint with an airbrush, I must set it up, unpack everything, and then clean it and pack it, because I don't have it.
Old school brush work.
Yeah. So yeah, I love painting with a brush. But yeah, if you like painting with an airbrush, it's probably the same, because you will apply. Make a sketch with an airbrush, not with paint, with those midtones and shadows, but with an airbrush. And then you can, with glazes, modify it. You can filter it, you can change, you can add more light. But it should be faster if you know the tool. So also for mixing shadows, mixing paints, even if you try to replicate something like I done here, try to limit yourself to maximum 9-10 colors if you want to do it faster, because sometimes when you mix some paints, they have a very big difference in volume. Yeah, so this one is darker, this one is brighter. If I would mix those paints, then even the mixture, even to even, will have a big difference between those two paints. So to achieve a smooth surface, you should even make more mixtures. But try to limit yourself to around 10 max. For me, it's 10. So when I add more, I paint away longer. So it takes more time. And doing this setup, you always can go back to the colors you were using earlier. You don't have to mix them live, so the mixture won't change. for making glazes, the dilution of the paint is very important. When I finish, if you can come here, you can check the dilution, because maybe it will help you. For me, it's the paint should be milky, and you shouldn't have there shouldn't be too much paint on the brush. Only it should be damp, a little damp, but that's all. And it's a maybe you will have. I have a habit. For me, it's like making lines, like drawing with a pencil. So you only do something like this. It's sufficient. You can change the direction of those lines to make an even smoother surface, but that's all.
Is this the way to control the saturation?
As for the saturation, the color is more saturated when it's painted on a brighter background. So if you make put the color on here, for instance, it will be more saturated than in the deep shadow. So I use the undercover to the sketch with the what that I use the sketch that I make with the airbrush to control the saturation. So at first, when I painted this one, I haven't covered the whole element with dark paint. Because if I would do, I would lose the brighter spots that give me the saturation with brighter colors. And I only have put the brighter colors on the places where the light should be. So they are saturated as they should be there because of the sketch that I made earlier. And that's why I don't add white to paint and I don't white add black. Maybe I only paint with white and black when I paint non-metallic metal and black, just black surfaces.
So you said that we shouldn't use the black surfaces, whole black surfaces as a start. So
No. Because you could kill the saturation of the miniature.
Yeah. When you are trying to do such thing with skin, which is bright.
Yes.
Isn't it easier to use the white surface as a start?
Yes, but the skin, then the whole skin will be fully saturated, and the whole skin will be will be brighter. So if we want to achieve the shadow, deep shadow, the dark shadow that is under maybe an arm or maybe lower on the miniature, if you would paint it on the white, it would be too saturated.
Yeah. So what's the difference between lightness of color and saturation of color? Because this is really...
Yes, it's the difference is that because there are some aspects of color. If you read about color theory, then we will see that something like saturation as a something that describes color, but also chroma, mm-hmm. and also of light and shadow that determines. So even if you open Photoshop or a program like this, if you open the color picker, you will see a box. And here you will say white,
black,
red, and a mixture here of those three.
Yeah.
So here it's full white. And the color picker is a, for me, it's something like a three-dimensional representation of the single color on the color wheel.
Yeah.
So the color wheel, as I told you, it's a wheel. It's a flat wheel. It doesn't show white or black. If you would add white to all those colors on the color wheel, all of them will be brighter. All of them. If you would add black, all of them will be darker. If you will add more dark, we will achieve black. If we add more white, you achieve only the white. So you can see adding white and black transposes it to a three-dimensional figure. Yeah? So some two points, one white, one black, and here in the middle the color wheel. Because the color wheel shows only the color on the outside that is most saturated, and on the inside it's less saturated because it's mixed together. So here you have saturation on the color wheel. Yeah? Brightness, darkness is achieved by adding white and black. So all those paints have mixtures. When I mixed the skin color, I added white because it was orange. But you achieve the skin color by adding white, because so it's lighter. So skin is orange but with white. So that's why I told you that you should, using something like a color wheel, you should think about your colors, where their place, what additions of color they have. And the next thing is that every color has its chroma. The standard color wheel doesn't show it. There's a color wheel that's called the Munsell color wheel, and it shows full chroma. So it's a bigger concept. It's not so intuitive to show, but it shows also the chroma of each color. So, as I told you, those colors have more chroma, but blue doesn't have that much. And also it translates on how the color looks on different surface. So if you would paint, everybody of you has the same problem. If you paint with this color on black, it would look like shit. Yeah? Yes, and you should add maybe three, four layers of this to achieve the color. But if you would paint with this color on black, it would look like this color, because this color looks better on black. But if you would paint with this color on white, then it would look like this. Or maybe you would use one layer, that's all. So that's why I make this sketch, to achieve full chroma of colors. Because it's easier to achieve pure yellow, pure red, that is strong. Also, there's a trick for painting red and yellow. If you want to make the color strong, we can do something like this. So first, cover the surface. Even if I would use maybe not those colors, but yellow colors. If I would want to achieve the saturated color of yellow, I would paint also the shadows, everything. But at some point, I will make something like this. Maybe here. Something like this. And then I would overpaint it with yellow to achieve saturated yellow. So, because you can build shades, you can build everything, and it's very important that the color, the yellow color, will be desaturated in the shadows, will be less, not that strong. But in the highlights, if you want to achieve a saturated color, paint it in white. So most of the time, maybe when materials like red, like yellow, I do something like this. I go to this stage, maybe this stage, and I make a dot that is very bright, very white, and then I cover it with yellow, because the yellow needs the white background to achieve its full saturation. So we can see here, it's yellow here. It's a small difference, but it's the same paint, the same dilution. So you can see the how it covers on white and black.
The sharp edges, because if you paint the dots, you make the arterial smoother,
Yes.
What about sharp edges if you want achieve?
You shouldn't mark them strong, because soft surfaces won't have sharp edges.
But sometimes the...
Yes, you want to make a element that has strong sharp edges to look it soft. Then don't paint the lines. Because we miniatures have something that is called outlining. And it's, in my opinion, is wrong. Because you artificially outline elements to show those elements, to make them pop out, to make them visible. But if you use a lot of light, some lines won't be visible. You can make outlines from above, but not from the bottom. Also for... I've read something about this. It's a technique to show shades, yeah? So sometimes you shouldn't paint very hard shadows because you make an outline for the... If we talk about the face and the hair, oh, that's a good example. So if you paint the whole face, like here, yeah? And then make a sharp outline with a very dark color, but on the whole face, even in places that are very lit, then if you paint the hair, it would look like a wig, because the transition of shadow would be too strong. So you will paint an artificial separation of the hair and the skin. And even if you look in the mirror, there isn't a line where the hair start. Because they are very random. So even you can make random lines for the hairline. But it's better to do it on bigger miniatures. But remember, when painting in very lit places, probably here I wouldn't make very strong shadows here. Because it will be a very strong separating line that distinguishes this element and the skin. So it's not natural. But depending on the placement of the element. So if you tell about the outline, there's a way to deal with it, because the outlines on soft elements have a way that you, when putting maybe material or something other, maybe an arm over the material, scratching it. If the character moves, he moves his hands. He wears the material out. Yeah. So there are places that you can use this. So here, maybe the material can be worn from above, because he will, by moving his hands, maybe doing something, he will add a little more texture, more scratches. So we can mark the outline, but don't make a line, but use strong random dots.
Okay, but for example, his hammer is like a cube. That's
yes.
Type. And if you want to make it like a cube, it should be the sharp edges around the cube.
Yes, but it's metal. The hammer should be sharp. But you can use different light sources, different colors of the light source, to show different lines. So, for example, here there's a lot of light. So here you can make the outline. You may mark the line of the sharp line. But here, and even on the bottom here, you won't mark it because there isn't too much light. And here is where the ambient light kicks in. Because I've showed you that you can achieve it by using material, yeah? So imagine that he's on a blue surface. So we can see that the whole bottom will be lit by blue. So you can add the ambient light. It's not that strong as the light from above. But the bottom of the hammer will be lit by blue. And the outlines you can also mark a little with blue. So I would do this thing. So we can use different colors of the surfaces that are around the miniature. As I told you, for this one I will be using a lot of green, because he will have a lot of foliage that will reflect light from the bottom. So the hammer probably here will be green. A little greenish, will have accents of green. So and also we will achieve a contrast, because normally the hammer we have I will paint non-metallic metal, so we will have a lot of blue, and blue-green will give you a lot of contrast. So maybe even if you paint non-metallic metals, try to add different colors. Maybe something like this, like maybe not Iroko, but something like this. It's gray, but with additions of small amounts of yellow, maybe even this one, birch. Yeah, you can add such colors, because if you add such colors, then the blue on the metal will be more visible. So it will shine, it will look more blue. If you paint the whole non-metallic piece with blue gray, you won't see the blue-gray color in it. But if you add some mixtures of warm color to contrast it, then you will see it. So it's cool to operate with something like this. As for the soft material, you can make something like this. Just here, where there's more light, maybe more surface that will be in place where the material will be used more. You can add on the, not don't make an outline like this, but add some dots just to mark it. That's all. That's sufficient. Okay, must add the final highlight. And that's it. So when we finish, you can approach, you can see the difference. So here I painted only with dots, here only with the side of the brush with glazes. And you can see the here the strap is very is smoother, and here you can see the dots. There is a texture, but you should remember about the dilution of the paint, the most important part in glazes. You can and for as I told you, for those paints they should be more diluted more, and for Games Workshop you only can add thinner, a drop of thinner, and that's sufficient. And if you feel that the paint is even too diluted, or maybe less, you can add or not add the thinner. So I always dab the paint, the brush in the paint, and then a little with thinner. So we have a very thin coat that we apply. So it's mostly filtering the surface, but the pigment should catch, so it should be visible. But yeah, that's it.